This is a special podcast presentation from 700WLW.com. This is Casey Boland On Demand.
And Casey Boland joins me now. He's with Hangold Capital Management. Casey, playing with statistics, this is done a lot, and sometimes you can spot them a mile away, some not. But as an example here, people were asked about how well they could save money. Explain how the question was phrased.
Well, one group was asked if they thought it was possible to save 20% of their income, and about 50% of them responded, said yes. And the other group was asked if they could live on 80% of their income, which means that they would be saving the remaining 20%. That was implied. Mm-hmm. In this group, nearly 80% said yes.
So 80 versus 50. Same question.
Same question, just posed in a different way. And, you know, how a question is framed can play a huge role in how we interpret certain statistics. And this is just one of the many ways numbers can fool us. And we see this all the times in headlines. They can be very misleading. A perfect example, recently in the Wall Street Journal, Kevin Warsh, he was a former member of the Federal Reserve Board, and he wrote, here's his quote, "A simple troubling fact, from the beginning of 2008 to the present, more than half of the increase in the value of the S&P 500 occurred on the day of the Federal Open Market Committee decisions." That's the end of his quote. It's an interesting statistic, and you hear a lot of people who've had similar conclusions.
Yeah, the difference is it depends on the starting point of when he measured that, though.
That's right. So if you look at the numbers since 2008, the S&P 500 is up 78%, and the FOMC meets 8 times a year to announce interest rate decisions. And using those 8 days ever since 2008, the S&P is up over 38%, which is roughly half of the return. So you know what? Hey, maybe he and others must be right. The Fed is behind the movement of the stock market. But you're exactly right. When you change the starting point a bit, the numbers change quite drastically.
All right. So go with 2009. Then what happened? If it were measuring from 2009 instead of 2008.
Well, then the S&P from 2009 is up 181%, and the market was up a total of 22% on the days the Fed made interest rate decisions. So using that starting point, they really pushed it about 12% of the total move of the market. So huge difference by changing the time period a little. Even the outcome, whether it's 2010, 11, right. 12, 13, very little of the return came from the Fed, how they made interest rate decisions. But, you know, when we hear data, statistics require context and critical thinking. And, yeah, they're helpful in forming an opinion, but we can twist them. And there's that old saying, it's so true, if you torture the data long enough, you can make it confess to end.